Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to the third session of the equity investing module of the I3T3 mega webinar 2019 edition 2. The topic for this session is fundamental analysis of stocks. Before we move on, please have a quick look at the disclaimer. So let's move on to simplified fundamental analysis. So which are the stocks that we need to buy? So friends, fundamental analysis is a very broad subject. If you guys have a look at the book, The Intelligent Investor, okay, which is considered to be the Bible of value investing or one of the, you know, significant or the key books which preaches the concept of fundamental investing, you will get sleepy. I have spoken to hundreds of people who have read the book, and the first thing they say is initial 100 pages we sleep. The one book which really excited me from an investment perspective is one written by William O'Neill. Of course, the concepts of this book has been introduced into our modules. It really excited me because he tried to simplify the overall process with rules and regulations. So what we have done today is to define fundamental analysis with simple rules. I have 10 funda rules which we want to check in each and every aspect of a company. All right. So these 10 parameters will help us to identify the best possible 10-20 stocks for our activity, and those 10-20 high prospective stocks we will wait for the best opportunity to buy using our principles of GAN and price action to enter. So that combined will form the overall thought process of techno fundamental analysis. Okay, now there are 10 different parameters that we look for in a company. They are listed here: market cap, quarterly earnings, annual earnings, price to book value, management holding, debt status, return on the equity, return on the total price to sales, and finally the operating profit margins. And there are additional couple of parameters which are critical. Fundamental analysis fundamentally is a never-ending topic. Because if you go deep diving on various concepts of fundamentals, there is no end to it. There are thousands of companies. You will have your own challenges to identify them. So what we strongly believe is we have 10 to 12 strong parameters that we check. If a company is good in these aspects, then we will ensure that we make relevant entry using technicals, which is a multi-layer filtering process. There is a funnel where you filter the top stocks using fundamental. There is a second level funnel which you use to filter using technicals. There is a third level funnel which you use to protect through position sizing, risk management, and so on. So finally, you are protected from the downside risk. When your downside risk is protected, your upside is assured. Because the upside is a matter of time. Okay, now let's get into each and every aspect of fundamental analysis one by one. The first and foremost concept is called as the market capitalization. Okay, in simple words, we call it as the total valuation of the company. Okay, it is simply calculated by the total number of shares that are floating in the world for that particular company and the current latest market price of the share. Where will you get my latest market price of the share? You can go to BSE site, NSE site. You can just check what was the last trading price of yesterday, Friday end of day. You will get the market share. Then total number of shares, you can go and check it in the BSE NSE website also. Or the company will anyway declare, no, the total outstanding shares are this much. Now, in simple words, let me take a marker and mark it in simple words so that everyone would understand. People who are already aware, kindly spare your time, because let me have a paint. Okay, so let's say I have a company, I have about 10 partners. Okay, and these 10 partners, all of them have invested 1 lakh or say 10 lakhs each into the business. Okay, so 10 lakh is total investment is 100 lakhs, which is 1 crore. This is the total investment done as of right now. So the market cap of this company is 1 crore. Why? That is the investment we have made right now. Now let's say I have shares of 1 rupee each. Each share is 1 rupee each. So what happens? The total market cap of 1 crore divided by 1 rupee is again 1 crore shares. So how many shares each of us will get? Everybody will get 10 lakh shares because everybody invested 10 lakhs. How many, what is the stake of each person? Every person holds 10% stake. Now let's say tomorrow, because of business performance, sales will improve, margins will improve, in turn earnings will improve. Okay, now let's say my company is a listed company in the exchange. When the company improves in terms of sales, in terms of earnings, what would happen? People would be happy to buy the company shares. So then what they do, the 1 rupee share will command a premium of 1.2 rupees, or it can command a premium of 1.5 rupees, or even it can command a premium of 2 rupees one particular day, maybe next week, next month, or next year. When that happens, what will happen to the total valuation of the company? The total market price is 2 rupees into there are 1 crore shares floating. So totally the valuation of the company is 2 crore, and all the 10 shareholders who had 10% stake in the company, everybody has a stake of 20 lakhs each. Okay, that's the simple description of the whole story. All right. Now let me go back to the presentation. There are three kinds of market capitalization. One is large cap, one is mid cap, one is small cap. Large caps are the big companies like the Reliance, the Tatas, the TCS, okay, the Infosys and other companies whose market capitalization is minimum 10,000 crores and above. Okay, and if the valuation is between 2000 to 10,000 crores, they are called mid caps, and anything less than 2000 crores, they are all called small caps. And there are some stocks whose valuation is less than 500 crores, they are called penny stocks or penny caps. There are many players in market who also want to buy the small penny stock companies, assuming that they will grow bigger. And the typical investment rationale for any investor is they'll put about 50% in large caps, 30 to 35% in mid caps, and 15 to 20% in small caps. Now, what are we? We are traders and investors too. That's the character I define. If somebody asks me, Ashok, you are an investor or you are a trader, I say I am a profit seeker. I am whether you brand me as a trader or investor, what is that I want? I want money. So I am a profit seeker. So I have 50% in investment, 25% in positional trading, 20% in intraday trading, and 5% in cash or expiry trading. So in that 50% of investing, I can have the spread. I can leave, say, 25% for large caps, 15% for mid caps, and 10% for small caps. This is a typical approach most of the people follow. Okay, if you guys are very, very small money, if your capital is less than 1 lakh or 2 lakhs, you guys cannot plan these kind of things. When your capital is small, look at small processes, play a betting size game, which we will teach you in the subsequent sessions. Once we talk about the price action journey, once we get into derivative trading, I will explain you how you should play your betting size in order to have an edge in the market, how to backtest your system and how to validate. So these are the 10 most valuable companies in the world today. Ruled by Apple, it was whose market cap was roughly about 920 billion then. Okay, and then followed by Amazon, Alphabet, Microsoft, Facebook, Okay, so look at it. The top five companies are pure technology companies. The sixth guy is an investment conglomerate. I repeat, he is an investment conglomerate. Seventh guy is again an investment banking firm. Eighth is a petroleum guy. Johnson & Johnson is an FMCG fellow. Bank of America is a bank. So these top five companies, look at the revenues of Hathaway Berkshire. It's 242 billion. Still, its valuation is much lower. Whereas look at the so-called technology companies. Their revenue is much lesser than what Hathaway Berkshire is. Why they're valued more? Because the world looks at those technology companies to rule the roost and make better revenues in the years to come. But remember the fact, companies like Hathaway Berkshire will stay in the long run. Many so-called technology companies can disappear. How many of you remember Nokia? The company which ruled the Indian lower middle class and the middle class market by offering them a phone on hand. How can we forget 3310? How many of you remember that 3310? That Moto phone. So today's generation will not even realize that such a company existed. How many of you know BlackBerry? There was a time when I got my first BlackBerry. I used to really show off that BlackBerry to my friends about 10 years ago, way back in 2007, 2008, when I became a manager in SAP. All managers used to get BlackBerries. You know, it was a pride to show. Research in Motion was the name of the company. Today, they don't even exist. Motorola too. Okay, so the leaders of yesterday need not be the leaders of today, and the leaders of today need not be the leaders of tomorrow. And these are the total unlisted companies. Understand this point. There's a difference between listed companies and unlisted companies. Listed companies are those companies which are public in nature, which are traded in the stock exchanges, and you and me as a common man can go and buy those shares. But these companies are popular in India. I am sure every one of you knows this company. Either you're touched by these companies, Uber, SpaceX, Flipkart, okay? All these companies, even Paytm. They're all private companies. If you want to take a stake in those companies, you need to take a outside route in order to buy those company shares. You cannot buy them. And look at their crazy valuations. Okay. In fact, for Flipkart, it was almost valued at 11 billion. I didn't even value it at 2 billion. If Walmart was not there, Flipkart would have disappeared because of the Amazon whitewash. But they were lucky that this happened. Okay, these are the top Indian firms by market cap, roughly. TCS is ruling the roost. Reliance Industries. How many of you know this interesting factor that the valuation of the entire Pakistan stock exchange is less than TCS? The valuation of the entire Pakistan stock exchange, like our Bangalore Bombay stock exchange, is less than the total valuation of our TCS, which is 6.5 lakh crores. Is it not interesting? Correct. Now, let's go to the second topic. Second quarter topic is quarterly earnings per share. Okay. Concept is very simple. Why would you start any business? The ultimate purpose of any business is to make profit. You can say, sir, we want this much of sales. We want this much of growth. We want this much of employees. All that factors finally boils down to one thing, that is profit. Okay. Now, how does stock market evaluate profit? How does financial statements evaluate profit? So every one of you remember that company which I started in the morning, that 1 crore investment with 10 partners of 10% each, and each share is 1 rupee, right? So there is 1 crore shares. Let's say my company made 25 lakhs profit this financial year. Okay. So what is the net profit after tax? I will talk. So anyway, we have to pay tax. Even the way you pay your employment tax, income tax, similarly companies also pay to corporate tax. So I have made 25 lakhs profit this year from my business. And what is the total number of shares outstanding for me, friends? We said it is 1 crore. So effectively, earning per share is nothing but total profit of the company divided by total number of shares. So per share, my company has earned 25 paisa. Okay, that is called as earning per share. What is quarterly earning per share? The way you have exams, you know, in school we had tests and exams, right? There was a test which used to come every month or every quarter, and finally there was a final exam. Similarly, companies has to file their financial statements, their earning statements every quarter. And based on every quarter profit, quarterly earnings have been designed. There is a question, is EPS different from dividend? What is dividend? Dividend is a portion of the earnings that the company gives to an investor. Earnings is the total profit of the company. Okay, now I will explain you what a dividend is, since somebody asked me. 25 lakhs is the profit I made for the company. So what will I do with the 25 lakhs? I will do one thing. I will retain 15 lakhs for additional expansion of the business, and remaining 10 lakhs I'll give it to all the shareholders. I'll give 1 lakh each. That 1 lakh each is called as the dividend paid to shareholders. What is the dividend per share? 1 lakh divided by 100, I mean 1 crore. So it is 0.1. Clear? Now, EPS is the money investor earned for every share he bought. For example, let's say you paid 10 rupees for stake in my company. 25 paisa is the profit you made. Okay? For every share you hold, you will get the actual profit that each share created for you as a shareholder. So for example, let's say you go and buy 100 shares of Infosys. Go and check what is the EPS of Infosys in the website. You will get a number. So that is a profit actually made per share. So you had 100 shares, multiply by 100, that is the actual profit that you as a shareholder made. But the way in which valuation stock is entirely different, but that's a different topic altogether. Okay, and there is one important thing that you should note. Whenever you do analysis, how do you analyze? When you in school, your mother used to compare. There are two ways of comparison. How you did in the last test, how you did in the next test. Okay, but there are some mothers who will check you, compare you with your neighbor's kid. Array, he got 90, you got 60. Okay, there are different ways of benchmarking. Similarly, in earning statement, you must benchmark yourself with the previous quarter earnings, not the last quarter, but the same quarter last year. Okay, why? Because earnings are seasonal in nature. Talk about any ice cream company, or a juice company, or a paint company. Why would people paint their houses in rainy season? It's a problem, right? So that is the whole reason why all these Asian paints, Good Luck, Nerolac, make more money in the summer. Why? Summer is dry. People would love to paint outside also, not just inside. That is why you should compare your last this quarter. For example, if you are comparing March quarter earnings, you should not compare with the previous quarter. You should compare with the March quarter of last year. Okay, and great companies, highly powerful companies, make a quarter and quarter earnings of at least 20 to 25%, which is a key factor that we need to study. Okay, clear? Any questions, Raghav? That is correct. Is quarterly earnings simple? Let's go to the next topic. Okay, the next topic is annual earnings. Okay, before we move on, here's an example. The total share Infosys is 435 crore shares. The net profit of Infosys in quarter ending 18 is around 16,000 crores. So what is the EPS of Infosys? The total profits made 16,029 crores. Okay, and the total shares outstanding was around 435 crores. So Infosys made a earnings per share of 36 rupees in that quarter. This is the simplest example we can give. And the next biggest factor is annual earnings. So the way you have every quarter earnings, there is something called as annual earnings, which is a combination of all the last four quarters cumulative growth. Okay, so generally great companies will make an earnings of at least 25% year on year. This is a very key and critical parameter. Okay, then how do they achieve year on year? That we will figure out. The best way to go and analyze all the dry companies is to go and check what they did. Why did Arcom went from 700 to zero? Why did Kingfisher went to bankruptcy? Go and check their annual earnings. Go and check their quarterly earnings. You will not see anything on the balance sheet. Remember, friends, if you want a great annual growth, annual earnings per share, what is that you need? If you need a very consistent annual earnings, you must surely should have a consistent quarterly earnings. Can there be a cricketer who, can there be a student in school who fails in all tests and suddenly become a rank holder in the exam? No, right? So all great annual earnings are a factor of quarterly earnings, and earnings growth can never come without consistent sales growth. Yes or no? If your business is to grow, what is the real growth in business? Growth in sales. When growth in sales happens, definitely that should reflect in profits. Of course, there are many companies where sales growth is stagnant, but earnings are increasing. What would be the reason? If sales is increasing, but earnings is still increasing, that means the company is cutting cost. They are doing lot of efficiency improvement. They are following many best practices. But how long you can cut cost? Always look for companies who make consistent sales growth. So where did we start? We started with the company should have good quarterly earnings. Next, the company, if they are having good quarter earnings, eventually they should have good annual earnings. But that annual earnings and quarterly earnings should be backed by very powerful sales growth. Okay. Now, the next interesting parameter. The most confusing parameter also. There is one interesting question before we move on. Sir, does seasonal variations impact stock market? Of course they will impact. Of course they will impact. There is a strategy in stock market. Okay, short in July and bid goodbye to market till the end of the year. Stock markets are seasonal in nature. All economies are driven by cycles. Okay, every economy of the world will have a stagnancy phase, a boom phase, a stability phase, and then a downfall phase. Again, a boom comes. Typical Wyckoff theory. It holds good for every business cycle, every product life cycle, everything. Okay, now coming back to the fourth parameter, which is the price to earnings ratio. Okay, what is price to earnings? Every one of you know clearly that what is the price per share? Price per share, which is there available in the website. You go to website, you just search for the stock. It will give you the latest LTP of yesterday. Now, second, what is the earning per share? Earning per share is very simple. You take the total profit of the company divided by the total number of shares of the company. You will get earnings per share. So what is price earnings? Price earnings is nothing but P by E. The price of the share, latest price divided by earnings per share. So whatever you do get, that's called as the P. But what does that ideally mean? Think about it. There is a price you pay. What is the price per share? That is the price you typically pay. What is the price of Ashok Leyland? 100 plus, roughly 100 plus. Okay, 100 is the price of Ashok Leyland. Now, let's say what is earnings of Ashok Leyland? Let's say Ashok Leyland is making 5 rupees profit per share every year. So what does it mean? Ashok Leyland's profit per share is 5 rupees, but we are paying 100 rupees for the share. So which means if Ashok Leyland has to recover that 100 rupees you paid per share, how many years does it take to recover? It will take 20 years to recover. Why? Because we are assuming that it makes 5 rupees profit per share every year, because market is commanding 100 rupees per share. Always remember, friends, one universal statement: the price that you pay for a share is not for what the company did till date, what the company did in the past. The price that you pay for the share is what you will do in the future. How many of you remember that slide where you saw Hathway Berkshire was having 244 billion revenue and all these five companies, the top rulers of the stock market, they had revenues almost less than that, but still they valued them more. Why? Because they believe that these companies will outperform or perform better in the future. Is this clear? Any questions? How much does the stock price increase when compared to earnings? The stock, whenever earnings growth comes, the stock price is driven by the market, is driven by the people. But earnings is a fact. Earnings is a fact, and which is there in the balance sheet of the company. Based on the earnings of the company, the market will react to it. How many times you guys would have seen the company is expected to do something, you will see the results are good, share price has fallen. Sometimes you see results are bad, share price has gone up. How many of you experience that in your trading? How many are earnings based traders? Tell me. See, what happens is that is what the people perceive. What, everything is based on information. Let's say everybody expect Kohli to hit a century. Okay, now Kohli hit century, what big deal about it? If a person who is an ordinary player, like someone like Bumrah, go and hits a century, you will be excited. Okay, that is the key concept. So generally what happens, even if the earnings are good, stock will fail because people expected that stock to make more earnings. Even if the earnings are bad, sometimes stocks goes up. Why? People would have thought that earnings would be much worse, but they're much better than what I assumed. Okay. So it's all driven by valuations. P is a factor which clearly explain whether what is the status of the stock. There's one question, sir, what if the number of stocks in the market changes, buyback, splitting, doubling? Okay, that's a different factor altogether. We will park it, we will take it up again later. Okay, right. Now price earnings is very, very critical. Why? Nifty currently price earning is around 28, which is highest in the history. Okay, and look at this particular chart. It says whenever Nifty PE is low, the stock market give rich dividends. So stock market gives rich dividends. Focus on this one. This is what mutual funds do. What will they do? The mutual funds, whenever the markets are falling, whenever there is a recession, they will buy more units, thereby bringing down the average price of acquisition. When Nifty PE is low, Nifty PE is 12 means probably in 2008 recession, Nifty PE was 12. So before, for 10 rupees, if you buy 5 items, now you get for 10 rupees, you get 20 items because price has fallen. That is why as time increases, the average theory of averages will take over and you will start making return. And look at this, be cautious about this. Nifty PE is currently at 28, 27 to 28. This is one bad reason which I am telling that I am not bullish on the market as of now, irrespective of where it is. However, observe another important factor. Even if Nifty PE is 27-28, a mutual fund investor should not care. Even in such a bad scenario, that guy will make this much money. Okay. So if Nifty PE is 28, it means overpriced, overheated. The economy is heated. Okay. And there is one more interesting aspect with respect to this particular price earnings. There's not only one price earning. There is so many. We'll talk one by one. Here is the valuation. Whenever Nifty PE is below 14, it's called extremely oversold. You just buy any stock you want and go fishing. There's a saying in America. Whenever Dow Jones go below a particular price earnings ratio, people will start buying all the, sell their houses, put all their investment in stock markets and go away. Whenever PE is above 22, it is extremely overbought. We are talking about 28. Lower the PE, better is the valuation, but lower PE stocks are not cheap. And high PE stocks are not costly. Because I strongly believe cheap stocks are cheap because they are cheap. You guys got this statement? Cheap stocks are cheap because they are cheap. So you need to look, whenever somebody is cheap, you need to understand why it is cheap. You need to validate why it is cheap. And if you find any positive edge, then only you should jump. That is an art of investing. This is the Nifty heat map of the last 20 years. Okay. Look at the Nifty PE of the whole 2018. People who don't know how to find Nifty PE, here it is. If you don't know anything, go to Google. Nifty PE today. Ask Google, it will tell you. It will show you. As of today, Nifty PE is QT 28.88. Is it clear, friends? So, which is in danger zone? All right. Now, here is the historic chart of Nifty PE, which I have marked. Can you see 2000 fall? Okay, now look at what happened in 2008 also. Nifty was 27-28 levels. Now Nifty has come to the same damn level. Now, somebody is asking, sir, does it mean that Nifty won't cross 12K or 13K? Think about it. What is Nifty PE? Price per share divided by earnings per share. If price is continuously increasing and earnings also continuously increasing, what would happen? Nifty will be constant, no? It will remain at 28. Let me show this. Understand this concept, friends. If you understand this, we are all set. Price to earning. Correct? That is PE. Now, this is PE ratio. Now, if you want PE to increase, what should happen? Either price should go up or earnings should go down. The denominator should go down. What will happen if earnings also, price goes up and earnings also goes up? Your PE is stagnant, right? Yes, sir, no, friends? If your earnings also increasing, simultaneous proportionately, if your price is also increasing, then your Nifty PE is stagnant. Then you have no problem. market can sustain at 28 for next few years and your price keeps on going because it is backed by earnings. Why I told you I don't trust the market? Because they are not backed by earnings. When earnings are bad, what would happen? When earnings are bad, your PE increases naturally. And over and above that, if price also increases, what would happen? Okay, so remember this simple concept. Okay. Whenever Nifty goes beyond 27 levels, there are always huge corrections. That's what history says. Okay, somebody is asking, sir, will it Nifty change every day or monthly basis? It changes every day. Why every day? What is Nifty? Nifty is a combination of 50 stocks. If any of the 50 stocks publish their earnings, Nifty earnings will change. Is it clear? Any of the Nifty constituent 50, 51 stocks, if they declare earnings, if that earnings change automatically, that will reflect in Nifty earnings also. Okay, and is there only one PE? There are many PEs. Okay, here is the PE of global markets. They keep changing. There is something called Nifty PE. There's a beautiful question, sir, but you said high PE is good in stock. I never said high PE is good in stock. Cross check once again. Which stock has more weight on Nifty, friends? Any guess? I am hoping HDFC. Yes. Okay. Now, there are multiple PEs. Okay, you have HDFC as PE. I'm sorry, Nifty PE you have. You have sector PE also. What is sector PE? All the real estate companies put together, all the IT companies put together. Correct? Even they will have a PE, no? If Nifty has 51 stocks PE, the software companies, 5-6 companies can have a software IT PE because we have an IT index also. Then there is something called competition PE. What is competition PE? If Maruti is commanding 25 PE and Mahindra is commanding 30 PE, who is overvalued? Mahindra. Yeah. So, but that is at a higher outer look. You can say it is overvalued or you can say it is over respected because of its better performance. So you need to deep dive on those aspects. Then you also have company's current PE. What is current PE? What is a PE as on today? You also have historic PE. The way you have Nifty historic PE, every stock will have historic PE. And along with that, there is company called as company forward PE. Many companies or many agencies will declare that Infosys will make this much profit next quarter. So their future PE can be around this much, assuming the price is same and they make an earnings of this much. Okay, friends. So there are totally 6 PEs that you can analyze. One is index PE, next is sectoral PE, next is company PE, company's past PE, present PE, future PE, and also competition PE. All this data is easily available in the websites. I will show them one by one when I do examples and explain you guys in micro details. Okay. Now, I'll take a pause. We finished 4 factors. If anybody is doubtful as of now, let me know. I'll take up some questions, address them and proceed further. Any queries or you guys are fine? All right, no questions. I will move on. Okay, there is a person who asked, can you brief me once again? Okay. Okay, so the fact is very simple. PE is simple. It is price divided by earnings per share. Price per share is available in the website, in the NSE website. Earnings per share is how do you calculate? It is that the total profit of the company divided by total shares. Okay, on the upper side, you have price, which is numerator. Below you have profit, which is denominator. When will PE can go up? If price goes up, PE will go up. When denominator, if your earnings go down also, your PE will go up. This is one important aspect everybody should watch. If a company's PE is high, that doesn't mean that's a costly company. It could be because their earnings are pathetic. Okay, so PE is an important parameter. A PE has multiple PEs. Whenever you do a benchmark of a PE, for example, Ashok Leland is the stock under focus. So Ashok Leland, I benchmark Ashok Leland PE with the Nifty PE. Then I also look for automotive index PE. I will look at competition like Mahindra or any other company like Eicher Motors PE. And then I'll check Ashok Leland PE of the last few years. I will verify Ashok Leland PE of today. I will also verify Ashok Leland potential PE of future. Okay, all these PEs will help me to make a logical decision. Okay, sir, if there is a question, if the price of a stock is based on future performance, how come a higher PE is danger zone? Always, if your PE is more than your competitors, what does it mean? See, what is the edge between Infosys and Cognizant? What is the edge between Mahindra and Tata Motors? It's more or less similar. They operate in same industry, right? If you are highly priced, you need to be, that has to be backed by fundamental results. You need to have strong earnings or something. Yes, there is a beautiful statement. Sir, if PE is overheated, but it is backed by powerful earnings, then we should not worry. Very good. That's a good statement. But remember this, if PE is not good and if the earnings are amazingly high, that is the best concept, right? A low PE and a high earning can be of tremendous potential to grow. Now, what is missing? Price should pick up with the earnings. Price will definitely pick up very soon if earnings are good. There is a question, sir, why with weak earning PE is high? Sir, earning is denominator. When denominator increases, what happened to your price? It has to go up, no? Your PE has to go up. Correct, Jimesh. Okay. So I'll move on with this next question. If anybody has further doubt, don't worry. We will take it offline. I'll take one-on-one with you. Okay. And you can track PE regularly. Just go to Google. Google is the mother of all learnings. Go to Google and type anything, you will get everything. I didn't even know that there was one site. What did I type? I said Nifty PE today, it gave me the site link. The next thing is book value, price to book value. On one side, you have earnings. What is earnings? Earnings are based on profit. The second thing is called book value. What is book value? In simple words, book value is nothing that if you decide to close the company today, okay, tomorrow, today Infosys decides, boss, we are done with the business. We don't want to operate anymore. Let us close the shop. Let us clear all the loans. Let us make payment to all the, vendors. Let us collect payment from all the customers and close the shop. And whatever is the balance amount after paying taxes, after paying interest, after clearing the debts, whatever is the shareholder amount, we will divide among ourselves. That is called as book value per share. Okay, if a company is liquidated and all the dues are settled, whatever is the balance money is the book value per share. Now let's take a look at this interesting concept. I want every one of you to focus. Let's say a company has decided to close shop. Who is the first person to stake claim? If you declare, sir, hamara dukan band hoega. So who is the first person? Creditors. Who is creditors? Banks. They will come to your doors. As long as you run away with your business, they don't care because they know you will make revenue, you will pay the loans. Okay? The banks are the first people to come. After banks, next, your vendors. Whoever supplied to you raw materials, whoever gave you services. Okay, then outstanding tax, that you need to pay to the government and so on, blah 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 blah. Finally, whatever balance money is available, that will go to whom? The whatever. And there is something called preferential shareholders also. There are shareholders who will be in queue above you, the normal public shareholder. Finally, the public shareholder. So when the company is closed, after all the people take their pending dues and things like that, after all governments, vendors, finally the shareholders will get whatever is balanced. So why Arcom is trading at 3 rupees? Can anybody tell me? Because shareholders will get Babaji ka tullu. Okay, that is why Arcom is at that level. If everybody comes and stakes claim, you will have nothing to eat. Okay, so most of the companies will have very high book value. And remember, manufacturing intensive companies will have a very higher book value. Okay, friends, why? Because they'll have a lot of assets in the form of machineries. What is the biggest asset of Infosys according to every one of you? The biggest asset of companies like Infosys is not employees, is not manpower. The biggest assets are two. One is the IP, another is the brand. When Satyam left, they had huge manpower. Just because Mahindra acquired them, that's when it became value. Employees will leave. Employees are not assets. The true assets are their intellectual properties, their R&Ds. Okay, more than anything else, their brand value. They are the most valuable stuffs. Okay, they define the book value. Since those aspects define book value, there cannot be a specific price for them. And hence, book value is not a 100% true figure. It is an approximate figure. So if the price to book value, so what is price? Okay, I'll give you a simple example now. Let's say price of the Ashok Leyland is 100 rupees. Okay, current, it is 100 rupees, right? Let's say the book value of Ashok Leyland is 50 rupees. What does that mean? The price to book value is 2 rupees. I'm not 2 rupees, it's 2. So if book value is lesser, which is good, because tomorrow if Ashok Leyland is closed, okay, the price is 100, you paid 100 rupees, but you will get only 50 rupees back. So 50% you will not get. Since price earnings is a smart ratio, since book value is a smart ratio, we as investors will use both the ratios in order to make decisions. We don't decide on one ratio. Is that clear? Why we do not decide on one ratio? Because in your school, when you are studying in school, if your mother says, "Sin, my son got 99 in mathematics, but he failed in science," it's okay, no problem. Finally, overall score is important. Not how much you scored in maths, how much you scored in English. Somebody says, "Sir, let's check the book value of Arcom." Let's do that. Let's do that. Yes, book value is a hypothetical scenario. Nobody will close shop. All right, that's Arcom for you. Book value is minus 15 rupees. So book value is negative for Arcom. If you want, you can even check in money control. There is a beautiful question, sir. Should PB be checked only for large or small caps or everybody? PB can be checked for anybody and everybody except banks. Why? What is the book value of bank? Yeah, okay. So you should not look at some parameters for specific company, which I will disclose. Look at this this is what, see, he is also showing 13 point negative book value, which means there is nothing, which means tomorrow if Arcom closes the shop, what is the market price of Arcom, which is 2 rupees? You have to pay 13 rupees. Of course, technically you will not pay, but theoretically you have, that is the status of Arcom today, which means none of their assets have any value. Why? Because they have huge loans on their book. Look at financials. We'll see here. Can you guys make out? This is the story of Arcom for you. They 2009-10 only, their story was over. Why? From there onwards, sales never picked up. 2015, there was a 15-16, there was an improvement, and suddenly it went to dustbin. Okay, and there's a question, Ashok, what is standalone, what is consolidated? Standalone is simple, any company will have to publish their balance sheet. Consolidated, you will have to publish when you have multiple companies under a single arm. For example, Hathaway Berkshire. Okay, oh, Warren Buffett has 120 companies. All those companies he has to assemble in order to publish a combined balance sheet. There are so many conglomerates in India. Every one of you know Infosys, right? Infosys had Infosys BPO, some Progeon, and all they had. So everything will come under the single Infosys arm. Okay, so whenever the book value is lesser, you need to analyze every parameter. Okay, it doesn't mean whenever book value is less, you got a great stock. Sorry, that doesn't mean. When book value is less, what does it mean in 99 in English? You need to go and check science. You need to go and check social studies. Okay, you need to check all 10 parameters to verify if they are in sync. Okay, so there's this due to another question. Is Skinner data reliable? They are mostly reliable. If you want to revalidate, go to Money Control website. You can even go to Market Mojo. It's another beautiful website, free website, Markets Mojo. You can use this website to analyze them also. Okay. What happened? Is this guy asking money? Yeah, here it is. This is another beautiful site which you can use. Okay, when we get into practical examples, we will get a deep dive on those concepts. Don't worry. So let's move on. We're running short of time. Here is the book value of Nifty. What is the book value of Nifty? Book value of Nifty is nothing but if all the Nifty 50, 51 companies are liquidated tomorrow and shop is closed, what is the book value? Okay, book value is 3.3 as on December as on 2018. We need to Google with the latest charts. Okay, the next one is about promoter holding. Who is the biggest stakeholder of Wipro? Azim Premji. Similarly, the Narayan Murthys, the Nilekani's, the Balakrishna's family, the Chris Gopalakrishna family, all of them put together hold almost 15% of Infosys. Okay, promoter holding is very important. Any company where management holds significant stake, that means that management is serious about it. And whenever management try to pledge their shares, that is caution, that is dangerous. How did Satyam scam exposed? Ramalingaraju went and invested money in a company called Meta's, which is if you put Satyam back to front, it's that word will be Meta's. And it was a real estate company. Why should a IT company get into real estate investment? So these kind of things go open up. Kingfisher is another fraud example. Okay, so higher the promoter holding, higher is the situation. Always we should look for companies where management hold more than 50% of the stake. Why? If management is holding 50 plus, he is the supreme boss of the company. He takes all the shots. Why is Mukesh Ambani calling all shots today in Reliance? And today, even Narayan Murthy cannot come back and become chairman of Infosys today. There'll be a lot of unrest. Okay? Whenever management pledges their shares, it's a bad news. Why? Because management is giving their powers to the banks. So generally, why, what will management do if they were, if they want to raise loans, they will pledge their shares and raise loans. And whenever management buys back their shares from the common public, that means management is super bullish about the stock performance. 2018, early 2018, Mukesh Ambani bought back many shares of Reliance. Check what happened. There was a solid boom then. And you know why management pledging shares is a vicious loop? How many understand that part? Here is the reason. Let's say you are pledging 100 crores. One of the promoter of Ashok Leland pledges 100 crores to the bank and takes loan. Okay. Now, what was the price, closing price of Ashok Leland? 100 rupees. Now, what happened? Let's say this guy holds about 5% of or 2% of Ashok Leland. Just a remote mythology, an imaginary example. Now, what happens if this man, he's having this much loan, he has pledged and he has consumed that money for various purposes. Now, suddenly, because of a crash, this company stocks come to 50%, which is 50 rupees. Possible, right? In a bearish market, stocks will fall. So 100 rupees Ashok Leyland can come to 50. When that happens, what will the company do? They will say, boss, your 100 crores has come down to 50 crores. Now I have lent you 100 crores. Now come and give me another 50 crores worth of shares. So let's say he had, let's say 1 million shares. They'll say, boss, give me another 1 million share. Like this, management will lose grip on the shareholdings and slowly the banks will keep taking all the money. In this process, there can be frauds like Nirav Modi, our great Vijay Mallya, who keeps pledging all the shares, take money and they disappear from the country. Okay. So the simple thumb rule is management holding is very, very important. Greater than 50 is best, and always track management pledging also. And this is what happens when promoters pledge money. They lose control on business. The retailers will dump the stock because of the negative news. And if stock price falls, bank will demand more shares. And that creates a vicious cycle, which can be disastrous. Is it simple, friends? Okay. Companies with maximum rise and fall in promoter pledges. Okay. This is an example of various companies where promoters raise their control on how the stocks behaved. Okay. See, look at the quarter on quarter change. Okay, whenever they pledge, see what happens. The performance have been dropping. How many shares a company can release to general public? There is a particular minimum percentage that has been designed by the exchange. I guess it is around 10% plus, if I'm not wrong. Okay. And look at this pledging data. Whenever the promoter pledging falls, their performance improves. Okay. And the next most critical parameter is debt. Debt is what destroys a family. Debt is what destroys a company. Debt is what destroyed Arcom, Suzlon, Kingfisher and many other companies. Where do we get this pledging information? When we do practical examples tomorrow morning, I will show everything in a balance sheet at a micro level. Okay. Debt to equity ratio of less than 2 is must, less than 1 is best. Okay. What happens with debts? When your debts are more, your EMIs are more. Same thing holds good for all of it. You pay income tax and get your salary. If you take a home loan, you need to pay EMI to the bank. and whatever is left out is the money that lies for with you for expenses. Same thing holds good for companies also. When companies have more debts, after all their earning, they have to pay, clear the interest to the bank, and whatever remaining money, they have to manage the operations and pay the final results to the shareholders. Okay, do not apply the rules of the debts to banks. Why? Where will bank takes money from? Banks will take money from RBI. So they should not, they use their standard lending processes. They should not, you should not worry about that. All right. Now let me show a simple scenario. Now I want to start the same company which I was talking in the morning. I need 1 crore now. Those 10 people are not ready. Okay. But I have, Ashok has 50 lakhs. Okay. And there are friends who are telling Ashok, I'll give you 50 lakhs, but give me 50% share. I am not ready for it. Okay. So what I will do, I will go to bank and raise a loan of 50 lakhs so that I don't have to give 50% share to the bank. What is the equity of the company? 50 lakhs. What is the debt of the company? 50 lakhs. So the debt to equity is 1. And if the equity and debt are equal, company is considered to be balanced. Imagine I had only 25 lakhs and I went to a bank and take a loan of 75. Then what is the debt to equity? It is 3, which is dangerous. Okay. Why? Because most of my earnings will go for interest payments. I will not have money to operate the business and generate profits. Clear? Okay. Debts are very, very critical, and debts and equity must be in optimum. You can't start a business having 25 lakhs and adding 25 lakhs from bank loan. Huh. Now there is a catch. There's a beautiful catch. Let me explain you. Let's say I have a business. I have only 25 lakhs, friends. This is an interesting story. If you guys understand this, it's very nice. Okay. I have only 25 lakhs. I need 1 crores to run the business. But my operating margin is 30%. What is operating margin? If I do 100 rupees sales, I will make 30 rupees profit. But I don't have money. I will go to your bank and raise a loan of 75 lakhs and use that money to operate the business. What is my debt equity ratio now? Which is 3, which is dangerous. Still, I don't care. Why? Bank will only take 11% from me. What is the arbitrage I have in this show? I have a 19% arbitrage. People understand this part? I have only 25 lakhs to run my business. I wanted 75 lakhs to run my business. I don't care lending 75 lakhs from the bank because bank charges 11% interest, but my business can generate 30% profit on investment. As a result, I have a 19% arbitrage, and which is a big profit for me, and hence I don't care about a debt. So whenever you are looking for companies where debt is higher, look for operating margins. When operating margins are very high, you don't have to worry too much about the debt, but debt had to be in control. If the operating margin consistently fluctuate, for example, if it is like this straight line, okay. If it is fluctuating, then your business is in super danger. That will directly impact your business cash flow and put your business at risk. Okay. Okay, is it audible now, friends? Okay, I just take a small pause now. Is it audible? Yes. Suddenly last 1 minute there was a disconnection. Okay. Okay, all right. So don't worry, that couple of minutes would be right there in the recording. You should catch up. Suddenly there was some delay and I didn't realize that. All right. 12:40 now. So we have another 30 minutes to close up. Let me move on. Okay. The next thing is return on equity. So I don't know, even if the company makes profit, a major profit of the company goes in the form of interest to the banks, goes in the form of tax to the government. What is that I am getting as a shareholder? That is what is important for a public investor. That is nothing but return on equity. What is return on equity? It's the net profit of the company divided by total shareholders equity that we have invested in the company. And the great William O'Neill said that an ROE must be always 17% or more. Why 17% or more? That is his number. Okay. Higher the ROE, better is the return. And these all parameters are readily available, friends. You don't have to calculate anything. They're instant. You should know how to interpret them. That is all. Okay. Does your business make money? Yeah, we make money in books. High PE, look at this combination. A higher ROE and a low PE is very good. Why? The return on equity is very good. PE is very low. Okay, P is a low. If lower the P is good for us, right? But a low ROE and a high P is very bad. You need to understand these parameters. And an ROE of greater than 20 is considered to be fantastic. Okay, so our ROE is all about how much the equity investor investment. Very, very interesting parameter. It is nothing but total. Okay. It is price per share divided by share. Okay. How here? Earnings can be negative. Can sales be negative, friends? Company make negative sales? There is no negative sales. Okay, I will take a small pause now to reconfirm that voice is again back. Let me check the no, I guess it is good. Okay. I guess it is good. Because I'm taking the call from office. Anyway, no worries. Okay, anything that you miss, you can always go back and check the recordings. It will be there. Okay. So price to sales is that important parameter, because price can never be, sales can never be negative. And if price to sales ratio of less than 2 is always considered good. Remember, never watch any ratio in isolation, because scoring 99 in maths and 25 in English doesn't mean you're a topper. You need to check all the subjects. A good student is one who performs well in all the subjects, be it all six subjects, sports, you know, health, behavior. Similarly, a company is considered to be good if it performs well across parameters. Okay, and the last and key factor is operating profit margin. The first thing that you say is, "Array, this company is doing good." The first thing is, "Itna margin kitna hai? How much margin is doing?" "Array, is business pe 20% margin hai? This business has 50% margin." So more the margin is concerned, more good for the company. You like such businesses. How it's calculated? Simple. Total profit by total sales. If sales value is 100 rupees and every 100 rupees sale you are making 25 or 30% of profit, that is called the operating profit margin. Okay, on all these parameters, how to check, what to check, where to check, everything, all 4W, why, what, when, where, how, I will show you at a micro level. Okay, don't have to worry at all. Higher the operating profit margin, higher is the result. And remember, if the operating profit margin is more than the lending rate of the company, you are good. If you have taken a loan of 12% from a bank and if you are doing an operating margin of say 10%, what is the point in taking a loan and running the company? You better keep quiet. Okay, so the most important thing is that operating margin should be more, which is very critical. Okay. So how is it calculated? Number one, there is revenue, there is cost of all the manufacturing. Finally, there is something called as gross profit. Let me mark them. Revenue, cost of goods sold, and then gross profit. And then you have all the variable expenses like salaries, overhead, which are fixed, depreciation, amortization, taxes, and all other profit. Finally, you have operating profit. Okay. And finally, 6,000. This operating profit divided by total revenue is called as the operating profit margin. So 12, it was 6%, 16% in 2013 and 24% in 2014. What is happening to operating margin? It is increasing year on year. It is increasing year on year, which is very important. Okay. Okay, so this is a cockpit of an aeroplane. Okay, and the pilots don't waste time in looking at 100 things in the sky. Everything that is happening on the aeroplane is shown in the flight, starting from the pressure, the fuel, the water that is available in the toilet, to whatever level, everything is available. Okay. Too much study of financial statements will result in analysis paralysis. Okay, we will only deep dive on a financial statement when it is required. So what we do, we take an aerial shot, identify the top companies, and then we go deeper on each one of them to understand, because we don't have time to study all 4,000 companies. We'll pick 50 companies through various parameters and we'd go deeper on those 50 to identify the 10 best companies. And there are many more investment parameters that we need to check along with these 10. One is called ratings. Ratings are generally given by agencies. There are so many rating agencies, like CRISIL is a rating agency. We have this guy's CARE ratings. Okay. There are so many rating agencies in the world, Moody's ratings. And there is something called as a scale for ratings. For example, every stock you find in the industry will have a rating. This stock is like a triple A rating, double A rating, A rating, again triple B, double B, B, triple C, double C, and C, and finally D is default, which is the worst, and triple A is the best. When you go and check the rating agencies in their website, they will directly tell you ITC is a double A, HUL is a triple A. Which in rating agency should I trust more? Check all three. Why trust one agency? There is an interesting question. Can we trust the rating agencies after all the IIFL fiasco? You can never trust rating agencies 100%. First of all, I don't believe in fundamentals 100%. That is why we have technicals. Why? Technicals are truth. Price is reality. Anything and everything would be reflected in the price. So we need to look at all factors. Let's check all rating agencies. Even if the rating agencies are fraud, we have our filter, right? We are studying the balance sheet. Even if balance sheets are fraud, we are focusing on price, right? Even the price is fraud, you have our position sizing in place, right? So every level, there is a series of filters that we have. In spite of so many filters, we will still land up in a bad stock. That is fine. Okay, because we will not put all the money in one stock, right? And there is something called long-term ratings and short-term ratings. These are all long-term ratings, whatever you are seeing on the left-hand side. Short-term ratings are like P1, P2, P3 and so on for Moody's. But S&P, they use it as A1, A2, A3, B, C and so on. Both the ratings are important. So what does plus and minus signify? Plus is like rating. In schools for kids, they give, now my son got A plus, A minus, B plus, B minus. There are multiple levels. That's it. Nothing more than that. Okay. And here is a rating. Example, TCS was rated A with a stable outlook for long term. Infosys was rated A minus. Reliance was B triple plus. Bharti was B triple B minus. So you can have a look at it and you can get a fair idea, right? The agencies will rate. Of course, any point of time, it will not be shown. Yes Bank will never be shown in your ratings. Yes Bank will have highest ratings. But price will tell the truth. Fundamental statements will tell the truth. Even if they are wrong, price will tell. If price is wrong, stop loss is there. Okay, and our position sizing is there. We have to have our own protections in place to address risk. You will not know who is the next Satyam. You will not know who is next Kingfisher. There is one question, Ashok, what is amortization? There is something called as EBITDA in financial statements. It is called as EBITDA. EBITDA, EBITDA. Earnings before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization. Okay, for any term you don't know, you just go to the Google, you know, investment. There is a website called investment. Okay, you just type the term, you will get a deep description of what it is. Okay. So I'm sorry, one of our colleagues says, don't pick Satyam example all the time. I worked for a significant time of my career in the same company. All right. Okay, so that summarizes roughly all the 10 parameters of fundamental investing followed by the rating agencies. And now there are three more statements that we need to look at, which would somehow summarize the whole fundamental analysis in nature. In subsequent sessions, we will go deeper into the micro aspects of it. These are all the high level aspects. Now, after this session, we will get into the nuts and bolts of the whole story. Okay, there are three financial statements. One is the profit loss statements, the balance sheet and the cash flow statement. So as the name signifies, profit loss statement is that statement which talks about if the company has made profit or a loss. After all, everything that we do is for a profit. This is a simple example of a profit loss statement and how it looks like. Generally, it is separated by the yearly factor. You can even look at it on a quarterly basis also. There's an interesting question, sir. How long are the ratings valid and when they will change? The ratings get changed dynamically when various news comes out. Okay. The ratings change after all quarterly results. The ratings changes after management meetings. The ratings also change after things like, suppose crude oil prices goes up. The crude oil price can have direct impact on the company because that is the biggest raw material of the company. So rating agencies are dynamic in nature. They can announce changes anytime. There's no fixed time like your quarterly earnings. All right. Now, a profit loss amount is very, very simple. One is, what is the total revenue that the company made? Total sales divided by number of cars sold. Okay, then cost of goods, 5,000 is the total expenses that we incur to make it. And what you get is the gross margin. And after that gross margin, we will cut down the salary cost, R&D cost, sales and marketing cost, operating cost, internet, telephone, power bill, real estate, rentals, and all those things, and totally land up in the total administration cost. And then the final amount that you see is the net income. On this net income, there we will also put the interest. We will pay the interest to the bank, we pay taxes to the government, and finally we will have the total net profit. There's a statement, gross margin is same as gross income, right? No, gross margin is gross income divided by total revenue. Margin is a percentage number, income is an absolute value. Okay. So that's about the profit loss statement. We will study them in real with lot of real time examples in the subsequent topic. For now, this much is enough. And next thing is the balance sheet, which is always the most unbalanced statement. And the beauty of balance sheet is it can be used for any kind of cheating. Maximum cheating happens in balance sheets. Okay, balance sheet just has the assets and liabilities of the company. When you look at a balance sheet, what you typically see is, what are all the assets? There are two kinds of assets. Current assets is that, and non-current assets. Current assets are those assets which are instantly liquid in nature. For example, what is a cash in bank? What is the amount that we need to receive from our customers? Okay. Then what is non-current assets? All the machineries of the company, all those things are non-current assets. Generally what happens, the total assets have to match with the total liabilities. Liabilities are also two types. One is the liabilities that we have to, the dues that we have to pay to somebody, the payment that are pending for the vendors, the payments that are due for the employees in the form of salary, the tax that we have to pay to the government, okay? Unearned service revenue, you can ignore this term, no worries. And the total liabilities, what is the investment made up of? One is the total investment that we have made as a company, and there is something called as retained earnings. Retained earnings are the profit that the company earned. Generally what happens whenever, I will just mark this here, I will take a new sheet. So what companies do is what companies do is, you have net profit. So net profit, what they do, there are two kinds of things. One is retained earnings, one is dividends. So how many of you remember in that example I said, whenever we made 25 lakhs profit, okay, 10 lakhs were given as dividends to the company and 15 lakhs were retained. Why retained? That is the money that I want to keep for myself to expand the business. What if, why should I share everything to the shareholder? Let owner, shareholder will get some dividend. Okay, correct Mrinal, that is right. Okay, that is what is called retained earnings. Okay, we will deep dive on this aspect in the subsequent sessions as discussed. And the third and key statement is called as the cash flow statement. Because that will define the maturity and stability of the organization. Company generally have three kinds of cash flow. Okay, in simple words, I have to say there is something called cash flow from operating activities, cash flow from investing activities, and cash flow from financing activities. And to finally, whether the cash flow is positive or negative. For EPS calculation, we use retained earnings, right? No. for EPS calculation, we use total profit. Okay, so cash flow from operating. What is cash flow from operating? That is a profit that you make because of your sales, the revenue that the company generate. How does cash flow from operating comes to Maruti? The all the cars sold, cash received from customers. Okay, and then look at the next one. If you are in bracket, it means it is negative. Cash paid to suppliers and employees. Suppliers are vendors for the raw materials and employees for salary. So total cash flow generated from operations is 11,000 here. Step one over. Now step two, cash flow from investment activities. For example, sometimes what happens, you make some investments. The investment will generate benefit. For example, an investment can be putting some of your profits in a bank for interest. The best investment that Microsoft made is what? They invested in Apple. How many of you know that Bill Gates has a bigger stake in Apple? Okay, whatever revenues, that profit that Microsoft made, a major portion of it has been invested in Apple. That becomes cash flow from investing activities. All the dividends, all the, you know, profit that Apple investment is making, that will come here as an income in Microsoft cash flow statement. Okay, so in this example, it is showing negative because they made investment on an equipment for this financial year. And the third thing is cash flow from financing activities. Okay, look at this. Proceeds from capital had contributed. He has lent money to somebody. He has invested somewhere. It is giving profit returns in the form of interest. Okay. Drawings where they have recovered. Proceeds from loan. Payment of loan. We also pay loans, right? Does this investment related to same sector? Need not be. It can be any sector. Yeah. Satyam was a wrong investment. But there are companies who make significant investment in other businesses, right? People make great investments. For example, go and check the in any of the American websites. Go and check the shareholding patterns of Apple. You will see Michael, you will see Bill Gates, or even it could be Microsoft Corporation in the name of it. Okay, finally at the end, based on the revenues that company made, cash flow from operations, cash flow from investing activities, cash flow from financing activities, sum of all these things, it will show positive or negative. As much as possible, any company should have a positive cash flow overall. They should not have negative cash flow. If you have negative cash flow, you will not have money to pay your salaries, pay your vendors. Okay, so it has to be consistently balanced and maintained so that company does not get into any financial crunch. It's all about good management. Okay, so that's about the cash flow statement. We will talk about these aspects in detail when we take practical examples. Is summation of all cash flows equal to net income or gross income? No. How is that possible? What is the gross income? The gross income is coming directly from cash flow from operations. How can summation of cash flow has related to net income of the company? There can be investments on machinery. You would have lent money outside also. But they are relative parameters. And there was a statement made by Nicholas Darvas long ago. He said, all the company report and balance sheet can tell you is past and present. They can never tell you the future, which is an absolute truth. That is why we believe in price. Bhav Bhagavan Che, that's what they say in Gujarati, no? Any questions? Such a long session, I'm sure it might not have gone inside very easily. No worries. Once I upload all the recording into the website, you can always go and repeat it a couple of times tomorrow and in the subsequent days. You will get better hang of the subject. any reason why William O'Neill didn't believe in PE ratio in his Can Slim? That's a beautiful question. See, PE ratio is a subjective phenomenon. PE is not a PE ratio in isolation has no meaning. Okay, it has no meaning. So PE should be coupled with many other factors. For William O'Neill, Can Slim proved him, because I will talk about Can Slim in the subsequent slides. He clearly told that Can Slim had a superior edge than whatever Dow Jones were generating as a return. Okay. Now, Ashok, how to read EBITDA? Sir, we will go and do that in our exercises. You will get a better hang of it. Okay. So any more questions, friends? So our mutual fund managers should do all these fundamentals, right? No, they do a lot more. They do a lot of sectoral analysis. They do a lot of market macroeconomic studies. They do a lot of sectoral correlation studies. A fund manager will have a lot of homework. I will tell you why we are superior than fund managers. Okay, we are not superior than fund managers because we are extremely talented. Okay, we are superior than fund managers because our capital is small. Okay, I'll tell you why. Suppose you guys, you want to buy a flat, you bring 50 lakhs and tell Ashok, I want, this is my 50 lakhs, get me a good flat. Or tomorrow if somebody comes to me and say, Ashok, take 5000 crores, I want 10,000 flats tomorrow, next month. What will I do? Which flat will go and check? Imagine the effort that I have to undergo in order to identify those 10,000 flats, finding the builder quality levels, construction quality, pricing. They have a bigger challenge. Okay, that's what is the pain of a fund manager. Fund manager is playing on a bigger size account, minimum 3,000 crores to 30,000 crores. There are many tools which I will use and show you to explain you which fund is the better. I will do an exclusive session about that. Okay, so Ashok, will you show and teach all these aspects in a website in a focus bay? Yes, we have not even finished 25% of this session. Okay, no worries. That is coming in subsequent sessions. In depth we will go. Okay, all right. So great friends, with this we'll come to the end of the third session, fundamental analysis of stocks simplified. I hope every one of you enjoyed this session. I will connect again with you with another interesting session post lunch. Till then, have a nice day. Take care. Bye bye.